Before we get deeper into this entire thing, I must tell you that we are not professional orators. We are teachers, and then we are having students who have just achieved, and then why I'm saying this, because here we're going to speak our heart out. I mean, we're not going to really talk about anything which is what is to do with marketing or anything like that. But I would like to tell you a few things which I have gathered about last 2.5 decades as my own experience about this entire examination as how it has unfolded. In fact, if I can possibly share a personal thing, it was a reinvention of sorts for me also. After spending over 2 decades in the same profession, teaching general studies, various parts of it, I was at a crossroad when the UPSC syllabus was changed and 2013 mains happened. I mean, I think it was a absolutely new journey, and I'm not ashamed of confessing that I had to re-begin my entire journey towards that. Because the kind of syllabus we had earlier, 2 papers of general studies, KSG, as you may be knowing, that has always been concerned about doing general studies alone. And then at that stage, it was like, suddenly I was like, the right word is that Alice in the Wonderland. I have no idea as to how the whole thing is moving. Because the things they were having compartmentalized earlier, science tech means science tech, economy means economy, geography means geography, polity means polity, that thing actually suddenly evaporated. And they were having areas where the questions will be asked. They were having more of those interfaced areas than those individual areas. I mean, if I can show it like this, this is more overlap than those individual ends. And at that stage, it was becoming nearly impossible, if I'm using the right word, for being able to answer certain question just by sticking to the same area from where the question has been asked. Because the questions have got like some portions taken from economy, some portions taken from geography, some portions coming from polity, and then all packed up in a science and technology section. So it was like absolutely, absolutely messy. And trust me, I had to reinvent myself, re-look into that. Then I realized that probably the older approach of 7 blind men and the elephant story is not going to work. I mean, if you are preparing for economy, you can't really imagine that I'm only preparing for economy. And then if I'm preparing for this. So actually the whole thing, instead of being like single compartment, they all became a big orchestra. You can't play one instrument at a time, because unless and anywhere anything is missing out, you end up losing a lot of things there. So keeping that aspect in mind, I had to really develop a team, develop my own methodology, and develop my own system. But in the process, while I was busy preparing those general studies curriculum and then classes and stuff like that, there was big need which I felt that was there with respect to juxtaposing them, like dovetailing them, integrating them. And that is where I realized that information is not going to be enough. If I have got information available in compartments, those compartmentalized informations are not going to serve my purpose. So at that stage, the realization was that we must also focus a lot on our skill of integration. And that skill of integration, like any other skill, requires a lot of practice. And then we started with our students who were registered in our center to make them right. And then gradually we have seen the results of KSG has been going very high, largely because we insisted on them to really integrate. That was the word I was using initially. Integrate information. But that something like skill that had to be acquired over time. Somebody can teach you economy, somebody can teach you history. But the art of integration of history and economy with polity has to be acquired. And this is no mantra which I can possibly pass on, that hey, these are the things through which you can. Because every time those integration has to be done in the examination hall itself. But then if you have practiced those integration, I'm sure it gets easier. It gets integratable. It gets somewhere you can possibly understand that hey, this is how I'm going to go about. And then in that backdrop, we have... if I can name Anshul about that, he came to me and he says like, sir, aise nahi chalega. I mean, I was like, what happened? I mean, he says, you must design something which is where we can put all of them together. I said, what is that? He says, test series. I mean, you must conduct a test series, because the kind of things that you have acquired and then you are using for a small segment of students, unless you make them practice a lot, it is not going to really work out. I looked at his face up and down. It's like he's already an IAS officer. Why is so now? But he was so sure about me getting involved. In fact, I would forever be indebted to you for this. And then he insisted that yes, let's team up. Let's all of us come together, and then let's write some answers and show to them that how the whole integration can happen. And then in that backdrop, we have a child was born, and it's today is his birthday, KTP. And KSG test prep came into being, and I think you are witnessing something which is starting today. I'm really glad to announce the beginning of KSG test preparation that we have got. In fact, in this KTP, what we are basically trying to do, KSG test prep, I'm not mighty keen on giving you information, because I mean, and I understand and I accept that if you pass PT, you have enough information to become the topper of the country. You've seen that. So there's something which is to be worked upon on a later state, that is after PT. And that skill, the sooner you start, it gets deeper inside you. And that is what is where I am actually interested in. Don't think that you have got more facts and the more facts will deliver. It is something like, with due respect, I have been seeing some of those, if you don't mind, I'll use the right word, composed answers. I mean, composed, like they put all the facts together and let it ferment there and present me as an answer. It's like, hey, I have so much of facts, I don't know what to do with it, but that's not what I want. So we have been lots of composting happening as far as an answer script which comes to me. And there are some answers which are live, not dead as composed. And those live answers are something which is what I'm going to show, which has been accepted and then acknowledged by UPSC. In the form of high ranks that we are having in front of us today. I mean, they have been proved. So I asked Anshul that if we are doing this, can we actually sit down and then we can get some answer from you? And you can imagine, I'm going to see good number of you when you pass this examination. The last thing you would like to do is that sit down and write answers again. I mean, that's something which is what I am very sure about. And then came Anurag, and Lakshya, and then Thara, and Vipin, and then, of course, my favorite Chandamohan. And then he said, like, yes, we'll write answers. And Tina, I mean, she would say, like, yes, sir, I'll write the answer. And it was so heartening that she was the first to give me the physical form of answer, that, hey, here is my answer. And then that is because why I'm saying is a lot of demystification has to be done. Lots of defogging is required. You always think that somebody who has written answer and topped the country, it's something which is written as if, like, nobody can else write. I mean, I understand. We keep waiting that someday we acquire enough information so that we will write a perfect answer. This perfect answer is a big misconception which you people have got. Never there is a perfect answer. If you give me any question, I'll find some mistake. If I write an answer, you'll find a mistake. So this is a mirage that we are chasing, actually. And then we quite often wait that one day we'll have enough information to write a good answer. See, there are two things. Buying organ and practicing on an organ. What we do is that we keep buying organs, and we think that if you have the most expensive rifle, we can shoot very well. That's not the way. That's not the way it goes. You should practice. You should practice. You should practice. Irrespective of whichever rifle you have got, you are shooting at the right location where you're supposed to be. If you practice the organ that you have got in your hand, you perfectly play that organ well. But then this practice is something which is most ignored aspect of our preparation. Because most of us, I would imagine, are lazy. I mean, we find a shorter cut. And then when we get some information, we feel very happy. Yes, I have got this information. But then it's not that those information which is going to matter ultimately. What you can possibly do with those information is very important. And then this packaging is one component, which is, I suppose, is a big missing link, in fact, I would say, in our total preparation. What we do is that we just put all the things as if like thrown on the face of the examiner. Just take it. No, it's not the fact which is important. In fact, if you don't know how to really package and how to pilot your answer, it is very difficult to get the marks that you deserve to be given by the examiner from there. And this will only come with practice. And one way of getting this practice done is by the simple methodology of putting you through some schedule of writing answer. putting your schedule of the writing test. See, we are having, in the kind of current schemes of things that we have got, probably you have been given handout about that, we will be having those 12 tests plus 2 essays that we have got. This very act of you getting into this tunnel of test series ends up or leaves you with at least, let's say if I am taking up 20 questions, 240 questions that you have written. And 240 questions which you have written, I suppose that's a decent forced practice that you are able to get. And then what unique component we would like to incorporate in that is that where you will be given about some pointers where we will be telling you that, hey, here is your mistake, here is your problem. But one unique thing which I'd like to add here, we'll also tell you here is your strength. You know, the interesting thing, I mean, in this examination, you have to have some X factor in answer writing. When you talk to these people, when they're individually addressing you, you'd find that each one of them, they will talk about their X factors. And interestingly, X factor of each one of you, each one of those achievers is very unique, but they have an X factor. I hope you're getting my point. There has to be something different. There has to be something special in your answer, unless you have got that something special. And we at in this exam, we are going to actually identify here is your X factor. In interview also, we are working very strong in that. I mean, we have got probably the highest scorer of interview also with us, 209. Amazing what he did to them and how he has got Vipin. I think we must give them a big round of applause. Amazing scored 209, and probably they didn't come with you to give some more back home also. So whatever they had in their hand, they would have given you. So you ask him also what magic he did in that interview where he got so much. So what I was trying to tell you is that X factor has to be actually identified, honed, and capitalized upon. This is what I'm trying to, and this X factor is going to be very special individual. You'll find that X factor of Farah is different from X factor of Lakshya. They're very different. But then there is an X factor. And that X factor I'm going to help you identify when you're writing this 240 question for me. And I have got a team of people who are from university system and schemes like that. They are going to really help you capitalize on your strength. I'm sure you know that I may be giving a rather crude example, but then you have got in different places, you have got different mithai walas are favorite, or the different samosa walas are favorite. I mean, in particular colony, this is samosa wala is very good. In some other colony, some other samosa wala is very good. These two samosas don't match, but both of them have got some X factor. I'm sorry to compare your answer with samosa, but then I can't somehow grow out of the foodie examples ever in my life. But then I must tell you that there is some X factor, and that X factor, I am expecting that this morning when you're listening to them first time, identify what is their X factor, what are the angles that they have got. It is impossible that you can ape any one of them, but then definitely you can hone your own X factor. And realize that, yes, I have to have an X factor in answer. Otherwise, this world is full of generalists. I mean, general people are everywhere. It is in Hindi, they call it hatke. That little bit of hatke is basically going to really deliver the goods to you. So my suggestion and submission to you is that please be very conscious of the fact in my answer, I must have some of my unique feature which I'm going to capitalize upon. And you can rest assured, I'm going to identify them. I'm going to identify in your answers that here you have got something which you can capitalize upon. And then the trend would emerge over time. It's not in the first answer, the second answer, third answer, but gradually I'll be able to really identify that X factor for you. In fact, in this exam that you're looking at, there are so many things that we need to be keeping in mind. In fact, when I am putting you into the test series, I would assume that you are going to the real world is state effect. I mean, that's something which is very, very important. Unless you get into that state effect in the sense like sitting in the examination-like condition, sitting for those many hours, sitting with that nature of question, sitting with that kind of a stress, sitting with that limited information, sitting with all kind of possible stresses that you have got, you tend to manage them better in the examination hall. Because there are lots of mistakes that may possibly happen, and those all mistakes would happen in the examination hall unless you have committed them outside. So what I am giving you a chance, of... let's say 240 times chance the same chance to commit those mistakes. So that I want that you commit all the possible conceivable mistakes well before you enter the examination hall. And don't wait, because this is the time. A lot of people would be thinking that, hey, I'm still in my earlier stage of preparation. Trust me, you'll be selected much before your preparation gets completed. You can ask these people. They would still be having some topics left. They would be still having some areas to be covered or done to their satisfaction. This is a mirage that you're chasing. Don't think that once I have got all the information, then I'll start my job. No, it's not like that. You can start your job, you can start your preparation, and then at the same time, hone the skill of writing answer. This is very crucial for me. And then earlier you start, the better off you can get. Actually, it is something like I would say, let's say if I'm talking about Tiger Woods, but then he is sitting in gyms working on some muscle. Why is working on some muscle? Because he has to use that in the field where he is going to do putting or whatever that he is doing there. So this is what is important, that you develop your muscles. You develop your muscles which will actually be there in the examination hall using. It's not that you can possibly do it right there when you're on the track. When you're on the track, of course, this is very little time that you have got to really re-improvise. In fact, I would like you to take, even if you have begun your preparation, do give some time of your busy schedule to this art development, because unless you have that art of writing good answer, this information is not going to take us too far, and you end up packaging, as they metaphorically always say, a luxury soap in a newspaper. I mean, you may be having vital information, you may be having great information, but those informations would actually not be really packaged well. So I suppose it is very important that you should be able to identify what are those. I think you people have heard about this Pareto principle, 80-20. I strongly believe that somewhere 20% of your answer get 80% of your marks. That 80-20 rule also we call it. So what is that? What I'm using the word 80-20 rule or Pareto principle, and I'm using this word X factor. This is something which has to be acquired. That, hey, what is that 20% of my answer which has been highlighted and appreciated by the evaluator? Of course, when we're giving comment, like, I mean, we give you like, here you can improve, here you can improve. But at the same time, which is a very unique component which I'm going to add here, that, hey, here is your strength. So if you know your strength also, you know how to capitalize. And this will be evaluated by different people at different time. And then if you see some trend happening in that, like, yes, people have appreciated my introduction. People have appreciated my conclusion. People have appreciated my fact. People have appreciated my clarity of thought. People have appreciated this. So I should be basically having this as my X factor, and let me promote that. And that is something which is very important. Otherwise, normal test series, what you have got, every time you come back with a swollen face like, this is not the marks I deserve to be given. No, at the same time, I think it's my important role that I need to play. I tell you that, hey, here is your strength also. And this is strength you have to capitalize, because you can never imagine that you can get somewhere around 70%, 75%, 65% marks. That's impossible to imagine. But then whatever limited resources I have got, how best I can make use of it. And that is what I am basically going to work upon, and then identify your unique component, which you can capitalize upon. I suppose, when I'm talking about this entire thing, you all know the importance of the time in the examination hall. It's very, very important. In fact, that I would like to say, if I'm going by those minutes that you have got, the marks that you have got, roughly speaking, every minute you have got 1.3 marks. I mean, that's something which is very vital. 1.3 marks for every minute. So every minute in the examination hall is very counted. And I would like you to practice. When you are practicing, you should practice in a manner that you are able to really save some time from the answers. Instead of finding some greed to write that answer very well, I should be also ensuring that every minute that I have written is in the direction of getting some marks. Power writing, I keep telling those people who are enrolled in the KSG regular classes, we try developing the power writing technique, in which that we have got every single sentence that you have written is fetching some marks for you. Writing something in generality is of no use. I mean, that's something which is what we will be like to tell you. Normally, what I like to give another foodie example for you. Normally, we just lay a buffet and expect the examiner to go and grace. It's a very fine dine restaurant where it's a la carte ordered by the examiner. So when he's ordering a particular dish to be served in a particular manner, I am expecting that you basically address that in that manner alone and nothing else. And keeping that aspect in mind, I suppose the time management becomes very important. And time management is something which we normally expect that will naturally come if we have got information. It has not come to anybody, including you. So it is important that we put ourselves through those test practices and try and see as to how the whole thing is actually unfolding for me, to be able to really know that, yes, my minutes are fetching me marks. My minutes are fetching my marks is very important. And that is when you have so many times when you end up finishing your answers not complete and not to your satisfaction, then you would be able to know. And that's quite logical. Naturally, it is happening often that you'd find that sometimes we go for a very elaborate introduction. Sometimes we go very elaborate main body. Sometimes we do a very elaborate landing. And I think that's crazy, actually. I think there has to be somewhat a quick takeoff, a cruising, and a decent landing. Sometimes we overshoot our tarmac while in introduction itself. I mean, we go so much elaborate introduction, we start teaching examiner. That's something which is a foolish thing to be done. So I would actually like to tell you that how to really taxi, how much you can taxi and then you take off, and then how much you can cruise. Sometimes you cruise so much by following the greed of giving more information, that you end up overshooting the tarmac and then the crash landing. That's crazy. You have to have a decent takeoff, a decent cruising, and decent landing. And this is not a thing which can be told to you or passed on to you here in the class, or it has to come through practice. And that practice is something which is where I'm forcing you to do if you're joining the test series. That's what I was trying to tell you. Apart from that, I would also like to tell you that you have a lot of things in which we can indicate to you that you have to pilot your answer in a manner that you would be actually making the examiner give you marks. How to pilot him? What to do about that? And then there's so many things that you can actually do by making his task a little easier. But then that is something which will only happen if you have done enough practice. I'm coming back to the same point every time. Practice. And practice also under the direct mentorship of somebody who's equivalent of the people being hired by UPSC for evaluating the examination. Because sometimes this answer is given to somebody, and then somebody is giving its comment, who itself is not qualified enough to give you a comment, will probably cut it from the wrong side. With due respect to the coaching institutes and my sector, it is very important that we take those suggestions sourced with the credentials from where it has come. If the sources are relevant and the sources are dependable, I think then only. Otherwise, sometimes this can be misguiding also. So I, with due respect to each one of them, I would like to take that these advices have to be very, very verifiable, and only then it is to be taken and accepted. Because you are at a very interesting juncture of your career where you cannot afford to take a wrong advice and then stake you 1 year. One mark, in fact, will matter a lot. So I was just trying to tell you that it's very important that we learn these skills bit by bit, gradually, and ultimately be in a position to really understand that my answer is actually fetching me marks. And if it's not fetching me marks, what is where the problem is lying? And that has to be told not once, twice, three times, but so many times over. And then only something can be acquired gradually by you. In fact, this is not the right place to really go detail about that. But then I suppose it is very important for us to understand decoding the question. In fact, busting the question is also very important. In the morning, I picked up a few questions for you to identify. Because a lot of times, because I believe very strongly in one fact, that once you are on the other side of PT, once you cleared PT, you have enough information in your hand to top the country. That is what I believe from last few years, the kind of nature of exam that has actually stretched. But sometimes understanding the question is very difficult. In fact, I picked up just 2-3 examples. We'll have some, those people who register for the test series, we'll have some classes also conducted to understand this entire thing in detail, taking real world examples. I'm reading one question, you can carefully listen to it, where it is very important for us to understand that the questions are not directly served to us to be answered. There's quite often a trap in the question. And those trap quite often take a lot of our valuable energy, and in fact we waste lots of words in kind of taxing. I'm reading this question, is from 2014, third paper. Drought has been recognized as a disaster in view of its special expanse, temporal duration, slow onset, and lasting effect on vulnerable sections. With a focus on the September 2010 guidelines from the National Disaster Management Authority, NDMA, discuss the mechanism for preparedness to deal with the likely El Nino and La Nina fallouts in India? This is one question, I suppose, it starts somewhere else, and the question has got its gravity falling somewhere else. I am reading this question again. Listen to it carefully. Drought has been recognized as a disaster in view of its special expense. The moment you see this question, drought, yes, I'm prepared on that. See, right, two line on drought. And then you see that a special expense, that in distribution, yeah, drought this place, this place, this place, this place, that drought, you write about that. Then you see temporal duration. Yes, I know when drought comes in India. I know the seasonality of it. Then slow onset and lasting effect of vulnerable section. Oh, it has got some social angle also. So let's write about how the drought has affected and caused some people committing suicide. We go there with a focus on the September 2010 guidelines of NDMA. Oh, NDMA also, I'm prepared. Let's write down NDMA, when it came and what are its guidelines. And then the question, discuss the mechanism for preparedness to deal with the likely El Nino. Oh, El Nino also came. I prepared for that. And La Nina fallout in India. Yes, I know all this. I know ENSO also. You think that's what the question is? The question is too far away from what they are there on the surface. And that is something which has to be acquired and understood. It will take a while for you to sensitize yourself. Otherwise, there's so many traps that they put in the questions that everybody gets gravitated, and then you use valuable time, and when you come back home, you then realize that, oh, come on, this was something else. So that trap practice is a very essential component which we would like to talk about, and giving some real-world questions that you would be basically using there. And then based on those questions, we would like to highlight as to where you have chance of falling in trap. Then also, small things, but then they matter a lot. I wish I'll just take 2-3 angles only. I have got about 10 different angles to really decode the questions. I will only take 2-3 and then probably talk to our achievers to address you directly. Another I would like to take you through is, that's what Anurag told me, 2-3 angles you should take only, not too many of them. So he's laughing at me when I'm doing this. Only 3, not take too many. We got this singular plural in the questions. They matter a lot. And quite often, we just thematically answer. I'm reading this question from 2015, first paper question. Discuss the changes in the trends of labor migration within and outside India in the last 4 decades. Listen to this question again carefully. Discuss the changes in the trends of labor migration within and outside India in the last 4 decades. If you're looking at this question, you can see the changes, trends. It's not the change that they're talking about. They're talking about more than one change, and that has to be taken care. And trend is not one trend, one pattern that you write. You're writing about trends also in labor migration within and outside India. So you're not talking about different streams of migration, only 2 streams of migration, within and outside. So changes of patterns and trends. If you look at that, where they have used S, where they have not used S. And then ultimately, the questions will be very different. In fact, I was talking to somebody, I am not supposed to be quoting him. And then when we're discussing with him, they simply would say that we don't give marks to the people for the simple reason that when they write answer, it's not something which I asked. So how come we can give marks if we have got somebody who has been asked and then has written something else while the question was something else? So this is where I would like you to be very particular about. In fact, I would like to tell you one more component. Quite often in the questions, one more sensitivity, is about parts of the question. UPSC has been, have you noted that in the last few years, been asking lengthy questions, very, very healthy questions, and so many parts come together. And quite often, the parts we are very prepared, we only get gravitated towards that, and we end up writing the whole answer on that part alone. And I'm reading one more question from this perspective itself. This is from 2015, the previous year. Why did the Industrial Revolution first occur in England? Discuss the quality of life of the people there during the industrialization. How does it compare with India at the present? Can you see that? I mean, there are 3 distinct parts of this question, and each part merit attention. And then when you are writing some test and we give some questions like that and you have been ignorant about that, that is the level when we would like to sensitize you. So there's so many angles that we have got. Quite often, these are small things as it appears. And since this is not the right platform to really take you seriously into that, but then I think I would like you to actually suggest, whatever way that you're doing, whichever place that you're doing, please do not be too much worried about just collecting the facts and then ultimately hoping that if I have information, I will perform. No, you have to give practice. I always like to give this example and like to quote it again. It's something like we just collect ingredients in our kitchen and we think that we become a big master chef. You don't become a cook unless you have practiced. You have to practice. And if you have practiced enough, you can possibly enter into a Punjabi kitchen and come out with a South Indian dish. That's possible. If you really have practiced enough. But then most often we think if we are having ingredients of a Punjabi kitchen, we can only come out with a Punjabi dish. No, you can come out with a... And that's what practice is the thing which I'm talking about. So I would request, in fact, that you please do a lot of practice now, because you are at this juncture when you have given the examination. A few days are going to be wasted just after the PT examination in discussing about the kind of question we had. And a few days are wasted just before the PT examination's result, waiting for the result. And these are very crucial hours and days that you waste. I would request that you ensure that you don't waste it, and then you are mechanically taken through some test, and then you end up writing. And for those people who are in the early stage of preparation, there you would always be waiting that I should have enough information to start preparing the writing answers. No, there are two things. You can learn those do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti. Even before writing the first word of a song, master the notes. That's something which I am interested in. If you learn the Saregama Padani well, then probably you can sing any song. That's what I believe. And then practice is the crucial thing, and I would insist that you should be giving a lot of time.